Are you the person who is looking for a property in the Philippines? You want to make sure your money is worth it pagka bumili ka ng lupa, ng bahay. Anong area sa Pilipinas ang magiging good potential in buying real estate? Watch this video.
Maybe moving on to the residential sector. Essentially, yung sa residential sector, what we are tracking here as a metric are the residential real estate loans. And what we've seen that in the past year, there has been an increase of year-on-year 10%, meaning more people are borrowing money, either from the banks. And even this is despite the high interest rate environment. But not discounting, that is still a very large factor that comes into play when people purchase property. We've always been following the news. Akala nga natin mag-rate cut na yung BSP. Then all of a sudden, sabi nila, they'll have to pause again. So yung market today, they're starting to, parang napapagod na rin sila, parang sa kakahintay eh. But now, what they're saying is that it will still happen, but it might happen in the latter part of 2024. And we need that as a sign. Kasi once the interest rates start coming down, not even by a large drop, just to see that it's headed that direction, that will fuel the market. And it will give sentiment that to buyers and also to those that are looking to borrow that, we're headed to the real recovery is starting to happen. So important. Yeah, pero inflation, syempre, di ba?
Yeah.
Maraming factors.
Yeah, tsaka pagka mataas yung interest rates, it allows people not to buy property kasi mataas yung interest. So, like what you said, pagka bumaba yung interest rates, at least it can be more attractive to people to buy.
Correct. Ang maganda lang rin sa atin is what we've noticed, no, lalo na those that own properties in core districts. When you say core Makati, again, Bonifacio, even though yung velocity or yung volumes have not been the same as before, yung property, yung prices na have has continued to hold. Ibig sabihin that it just shows that there are properties there that just even at a crisis, real estate is one asset class that can hold value. That can hold value. It's a hedge against inflation.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So maybe next slide. Similar to how we present yung office, again, very busy slide, no? But essentially what this is saying is yung orange are the units sold in each of these quarters. And then blue are the launches, yung developers that are saying we will launch a new project. Vis-a-vis with the underlying background of interest rates, yung 6.07 all the way to 6.50, that's what we have today. The volumes of units have come down and the launches have come down. But that is due to a few reasons. Outside of interest rates, definitely is a factor. But one more item there that is worth pointing out is yung mga developers before, during COVID, nagbigay sila ng what you call extended payment terms. Meaning that if you wanted to buy a property, let's say your down payment, you can pay it not just in a short period, but you can spread it out much longer. So just to fuel the volume also of sales. Ngayon, what some have noticed is that hindi masyado na-vet yung mga buyers. So nagkakaroon ng cancellations. And that became the thesis for many developers now to tighten the credit. To tightening the buyer screening, meaning they want to make sure that if you buy a particular unit, that you can afford the amortization, you can afford paying for it over the longer period. So bumaba yung volume, but at least the quality of buyers that are being vetted ngayon are of more quality.
Right. Yeah. Kesa like para sa insurance, kesa mag-lapse yung hindi matutuloy. So that's good. Bababa yung number, pero yung quality at magtutuloy, at least matutuloy yung investment. Pero Nico, I don't know if nakita mo rin in the news, I think last week, since nasa residential market topic tayo, meron naman developer, hindi kasama sa mga big names, parang nakita ko lang sa post FB, na parang they paid like years ago, tapos parang this year, turnover dapat, pero yung picture, reality, parang mga damo-damo pa. So, marami pang ganun until now?
Hard to say, but I think that is a perfect example of why sometimes what you call there's a risk premium, meaning that you pay a little more for the track record of a reputable developer. That developer, there's assurance that, you know, when the time comes that a unit needs to be delivered and delivered with the same promise that was given to you by the agent or the land developer when they that sold you that product. Kaya even though sometimes you can there's a new boutique developer pero di ba hindi tayo sigurado whether they are financially capable to deliver a project, mas mura nga, but in the long run you have to accept that there are risks involved.
Yeah. Kaya yung rant niya sa Facebook, aside sa sobrang delayed, parang wala pa masyadong post eh, yung payment nila, tuloy-tuloy. Pero siguro, since this is your expertise, for people who are interested in buying a house or a condo, any red flags? Kasi syempre, reputable naman talaga yung mga big, ano? Pero syempre, may mga certain budget ka rin na pasok doon sa medyo new player at hindi pa matunog. Ano yung mga at least red flag or at least things that you should be cautioned in terms of yung sa real estate pagpili mo ng property?
Siguro in terms of yung guidance when someone buys their own home, kasi that is the Filipino dream to own your first house or at least or earn your be able to afford your first condominium. What you need to do, I think, and probably Neil, you have a lot of insight. Yung financial, ano talaga, being able to understand your financial threshold. Are you at a certain point in your career that you want to purchase, or maybe it's actually better for you to rent? So to have an understanding of what that certain commitment will be. And some buyers are looking to purchase property for either for them to rent out or either for them to live in. So kailangan clear yun sa atin. Kasi if you are willing to or looking to find someone to rent it out, you have to scan the market, diba? What kind of demographic of renters will you be able to have? So for, let's say you buy a property in Makati. Alam natin that Makati has a lot of, diba? There's a lot of demographic depending on what asset that you purchase. But it gives you a higher chance that you will be able to rent it out. Now, the next question is, when you rent it out, what kind of rent are you expecting? And is that enough to tide you if you have an amortization or you borrowed a mortgage from the bank? Kasi what you want to be able to do is at least what you're earning will be able to match what you're paying the bank, not you spending more. So it's really more of a self-actualization, diba? Parang asking all these questions before you actually commit to these kind of purchases. Tsaka, syempre, basket yan eh. Diba? May stocks ka na ba? May insurance ka na ba? May real estate savings? Yeah. So today, what the pandemic has reminded us is that savings also is important, that we have enough in our bank that if the certain emergency happens, that we have an emergency fund in place to be able to make sure that we're not caught flat-footed. And together with that emergency fund, sometimes we also need to ask ourselves, have we done a deep dive into how much are we really spending every month? Ano ba expenses natin, di ba? So, kasi minsan di mo rin alam eh, how much you're spending, unless you really, di ba, diligently say, okay, dito na pupunta. Yeah. Then now you go, can I afford to rent? Can I afford to buy? Yeah.
Right. Kasi minsan, porsigido to live the dream, pero at the expense of hindi na talaga napag-aralan yung cash flow. Like, maganda yung mga sinabi mo. Pero how about sa developer side? Kasi syempre,
yung sa buyer side, o sige, dapat kaya ng finances ko, may emergency fund ako, na wala na akong trabaho, kaya ko bayarin amortization. On the other side, sa developer, parang may mga red flag ba sa developer na, o sige, iwasan ko to, o parang first project to ng developer, mag-iingat ba ako sa ganun? Or any, ano, pag developer side?
Yeah, I think, syempre, ano, like any new developer, may certain due diligence tayo dapat as buyers to be able to do. And minsan, syempre, information is not found in one place. Eh. Hindi naman yan parang you just go to a website and believe what you see there. So there's a lot of creativity na dapat we ask also certain experts, di ba? What kind of, have you heard of this company? Ano bang, who are the people behind this company? Are these people trusted individuals? Have they proven themselves in other industries? Syempre, it is also your money at stake, di ba? Your money, your time, your effort. And ano talaga eh, it's hard to leave that up to chance. So, not necessarily red flag, but syempre, red flag could be if you hear something that is from someone else na, di ba, that they're
integrity.
Also, syempre, the people behind it, di ba, if you know that these are people that are not, well, the reputation of these people have been tainted, syempre, mapapaisip rin tayo.
Thank you for sharing that insight. Kasi I'm sure there are some people who are watching now interested in having their own home, and that's why they're watching this, so that to gain insight. So, yeah. Thank you, Miko. Yeah. Sige, balik natin sa slide mo.
Siguro moving on sa next. Ito, this slide is essentially what we were saying. No? Ang tinatrack kasi namin are the residential real estate loans. So yung gray, as you can see, 10% increase from last year. And then in terms of those that are loaning, many of them are deploying it actually in horizontal developments. Meaning, they're looking at other parts of Greater Metro Manila. Diba? In the south, in Cavite, in Laguna, in Batangas. Because many developers are now starting to take a position na hindi lang vertical condominiums, but they're building mixed-use township communities. So, which means that like what you have in Nuvali, what you have in other places, na you are, the hope and the dream is that essentially it is a live, work, and play environment. So some developers are building that, but that is a 5 to 10 year or if sometimes even longer for it to be matured. Pero the buyers are also looking at that as an opportunity, an upside sa capital appreciation. Ngayon, what's driving that development outside is to what we mentioned kanina, yung infrastructure. All the roads that are being built today or have been built, ang maganda nga is during the COVID time, dahil a lot of us are actually in our houses, paglabas natin, some of these projects that will take 10 years were finished in 3 years. So naging blessing yun in a way because it accelerated the pace of development. And it does help na syempre may government that really puts a lot of effort in making sure that these projects are come to fruition.
That's good. You mentioned Nuvali, and a lot of people are buying there. May kaibigan niya ako bumili doon. Is Nuvali still a good buy now or too late na? Or ano mga areas sa Pilipinas outside Metro Manila is having a high growth potential? Calabarzon ba? Bulacan ba? Dahil magkakaroon ng airport? Ano yung mga possible areas so that people who are watching, at least they can spot those areas?
Yeah, I think many of the areas you mentioned definitely are candidates. No? The question there is understanding and educating yourself yung why you're buying in those properties. Kasi minsan, if it's a 10-year project, alam natin matutulog yung pera mo for 10 years or 15 years. So is that income that you can park and you continue to pay? At saka these properties, lalo na the ones that are starting, walang recurring income yun kasi it's not a property that you can lease out. Idle yan, either it's a commercial lot, so you will just wait for the right time for you to build your house or maybe in the future sell. So once you know that is a possibility for you, then that will help help you when you decide on these things. Pero you're right, no? Follow the infrastructure, and a lot of those lead to Cavite, Laguna, Batangas. in the north also. Exciting yung airport. It does seem like it is underway. Also, if you look at I was in the Mall of Asia area a few weeks ago. Interestingly, they are reclaiming another 600 hectares. Si SM is reclaiming 600 hectares. And isipin natin na, okay, baka ano lang yan. It will take next generation. Pero I was on top of one of the office buildings, nakikita ko na slowly, yung water, they're already digging water and piling the sand. Ganyan. So it's happening. So that area, well, yung dating ngayon, makikita mo yung water. Parang Rojas Boulevard yan daw before. When you are in Rojas, right, from Mall of Asia, you had the view of the sunset, diba, and the water. And then the Mall of Asia. And then in Mall of Asia ngayon, there was a change.
Yeah. Kaya pala, kasi when we were in Sofitel, Manila rin yun, may view yun dati. Tapos pagkita ko, uy, bakit may development? SM pala yun? Or is that the same?
There are actually four large proponents na gusto mag-reclaim. Pero ang reclamation project kasi requires a lot of approvals sa PRA and then different agencies. Ngayon, some of them are able to get the approval. Yung iba, pending pa. But yung what you are seeing is probably the SM reclamation project. Na yung nakikita mo na siya from the window na what's happening, di ba? On the, parang nagkakaroon na ng land, na at least landfill, di ba?
Nawala na yung view.
So, marami pa rin exciting things happening in Metro Manila.
Sige, balik ko sa slides.
Going back to the slides. So yun, what we just want to point out na maraming horizontal developments. So what you call, nagkakaroon ng decentralization nga, na hindi lang dito because there are a lot of mixed-use townships happening all over Metro Manila, Greater Metro Manila, and in the Philippines. Next. Siguro just to reinforce that, no, the on the right is you see many of the mixed-use development projects and then all the infrastructure projects that are connected and that are benefiting many of these places. So yung Calax, yung SLEX, TR4, Cavite, LRT1. And these projects are not parang imagination lang. Diba? Parang these are real projects that are, we see that some of it are completed, others are under construction. Kaya there's a lot of promise and kaya yung developers are positioning themselves in these places. Next. So, siguro just a few more slides for residential. This is a slide. Imagine to, if you were, kailan ba tayo? 1986 tayo, no? 1986.
Oh, 80s, ganyan tayo. Mid-80s tayo, mid-80s.
Or let's say our parents in 1991, they decided, oh, why don't we buy properties in Dasma or Forbes? At that time, Dasma Marina prices were at 7,000 pesos per square meter. And that today is 600,000. Pesos per square meter. So, but if you look at the line graph, diba, despite everything in the last 20, 30 years that have happened in the Philippines, whether Asian financial crisis, global financial crisis, COVID, or even all the things that happened in between, diba, terrorists, real estate has been a steady, luxury real estate has been a steady hand. It continued to grow in the last 30 years. If you just look at how the charts are looking. And even today, these are prime villages, pero there's very few people selling kasi the debt levels are so low. Yung mga, the people that own properties here, wala naman masyadong utang yung mga yan. So even though the market is not the best, okay lang if they'll hold. They don't need the money today. But this is just gives us sana some comfort that real estate definitely is a hedge to any things that we can encounter that we unexpectedly happen to our lifetime na mangyari like COVID.
Yeah.
Next.
Yeah. Kaya pa ba sa time, Nico?
Yeah, okay lang.
Okay.
Yeah. Sige. Siguro just one more slide for residential and then we do a few slides lang ng hotel. No? Next slide. Okay. So this is similar case for condominium to vertical. Kanina mga houses. So we're only taking a sample size of the luxury, where many of these places that you see on screen, even though yung yield, ang rent yield kasi means the amount of cash that you get or the amount of cash that you get as a investor when you rent the unit out. So even though yung rental market might be weak in some places, soft, kasi ang return mo 3%, di ba? Eh, you can get fixed income 5%, 5.5%. The capital appreciation continues to go up. So yun yung mga factors that you need to consider when you're looking at real estate. Okay, syempre, if you get a higher yield on your rent, but also the overtime, long game talaga eh. The real estate is a long game, but when you look at it over a 10-year horizon, your money could have really flourished if you park it in an asset that checks all the boxes.
Yeah. Okay. Discovery Premier pala yung highest dito sa Makati.
I think yung sa, yes, the existing, pero may mga projects rin ngayon that are in the pipeline na matatapos in Makati that are already trying to sell at 800,000 pesos per square. Wow. So sobrang very, very, ano talaga, for a selected for you. Parang pwede na sa inyo ni Marvin Neal.
Para sa'yo talaga yun, bro. Para sa'yo. Yung anong task din eh, yung sa Horizon.
Yeah, that's the Shangri-La development. The Shangri-La development. Yung Shangri-La Fort.